John Calloway interviews.
That is Sanctus, part four of the Verdi Requiem, sung by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra Chorus, which is directed by Margaret Hillis, who is my guest this evening. At 1978 Grammy Award-winning sound and performance marks really the excellence of the Chicago Symphony Chorus under the direction of Margaret Hillis, an excellence which has permeated the work of the chorus for years since its founding in 1957. And I'm curious, a passionate piece of music like that, does it help to have religious conviction personally when you're singing the praise of the Lord?
I think perhaps it does, yes.
Do most of your singers come from some kind of church experience?
Yes, a great many of them do. I remember the time that we were doing the Mozart Requiem, and it just happened to have been scheduled the week after John Kennedy's assassination. And I've never heard a chorus sing more fervently than they did at that time because of the text.
And so that what is going on in society at a given time can have an impact on music.
Oh, yes, it certainly can.
Now, is that a problem for somebody who's trying to interpret the music, say, of the 17th century or the 16th century and trying to be faithful to the composer's intentions there, and yet there's a huge societal thing going on outside the doors?
Perhaps yes. Of course, the thing is that in a rehearsal, in a performance, you try to be only there. Everything else is closed out. And if you're doing 16th century, 17th century music, by your own imagination, the force of your own imagination carries you into that era. It's difficult.
Is the music like the law? You want to be faithful to the Constitution, and yet you want to be open to the interpretation of the times?
Yes, I would say so. The way that music is interpreted has changed a great deal over the years. When I was a child, it was when the first Bach recordings came out of Stokowski's that were enormously romanticized and not at all faithful to the original when it came to the sonority, but it was marvelous. It was really wonderful. And when I was very little, I heard Paderewski play, I heard Joseph Hoffman, Rachmaninoff, and the playing was very plastic, very rubato. Then there came a rebellion against that, a rebellion against the whole of the 19th century, and everything became neoclassic. And very correct, and I must say rather sterile. And I think we're coming around again to this more rubato, more plastic feeling.
How do you feel about that?
Music. I like it.
Well, now we don't usually associate the word plastic with a value that we like. Can you use some other words?
Well,
do you mean plasticity?
Plasticity, yes.
The plastic hasn't hardened.
No,
okay,
that's
all right. Okay.
I was using it in the sense of something that is that bends and has roundness and curve.
Margaret Hillis, is it fair to say that a chorus is a musical instrument?
Absolutely.
Or is it several instruments? If you have four soloists and a chorus, do you then have five instruments?
Well, one thinks of a chorus as a musical instrument in the sense that an orchestra is, that you have to get balance, you have to get color, you have to get it to behave in a musical manner. Of course, there, if you think of voices as being a musical instrument, I always say that a voice is a musical instrument. It has words to deal with, and it's a wind instrument. It has words to deal with, which a trumpet player doesn't. But the larynx functions a little bit like the embouchure does for a trumpet player, a trombone player.
Is it fair to say, would it be accurate to say that singing is the foundation of all music?
Absolutely. I know once I did, I was invited up to Manhattanville College of the Sacred Heart, and we did a Schubert Mass, and I've never heard such beautiful phrasing in all of my life because they've had sung Gregorian chant all of their lives. Just a gorgeous sense of the curve of a line. Of course, to keep them together, the rhythmic sense was something else. but beautiful, beautiful sense of line.
All right, then if we can establish the importance of the voice as an instrument and of choruses as an instrument and as singing as a foundation of music, do you think then your very firmly established chorus aside, that we pay the kind of attention and put the kind of resources into choral work in this country that we need to?
No, I think not yet.
Why not?
It comes from a history of large amateur choruses all over the place. And the amateur chorus gradually broke down. We now have only one large amateur chorus in Chicago now, the Apollo Club. The old Swedish club is gone because the ethnic thing fell apart. The young people didn't come into the Swedish choral society.
So this is
they
a part of the urban malaise.
Yes, and they, a whole change in the whole society. I know once there was a chorus in Massachusetts, and I once went up to look over their library. They had 800 copies of Judas Maccabeus. They had 950 copies of the B minor Mass, and I think the chorus was actually that large. And this was something that people did just for fun. It was a hobby. And of course, it's very easy to sing. It's very difficult to sing well. And we have very few professional choruses in this country. Europe is full of them.
I mean, New York City, for example, has nothing, does it, comparable to the Chicago Symphony Orchestra chorus?
No.
Why is that in a metropolitan area of, what is it, 18, 20 million?
I should think so. Again, the right person has not come along at the right time to get something of this sort started. Of course, being a big metropolitan center, they have in the past been able to call on university choruses, things of this sort, because there are many of them around there.
There's so many singers. I mean, there's many choral singers of great talent, I would assume, in New York City.
Yes, there are.
But they didn't. Margaret Hillis came to Chicago and said, now, you were in New York in 57,
yes,
weren't you?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what happened that got you so involved in Chicago in 1957 when you founded the chorus here?
Well, I had a professional chorus. And it was actually, it was an aggregate of singers. And if we were doing, say, 15th, 16th century music, there might be only 12 singers in that particular chorus. If we were doing L'Enfance du Christ, there might be 50 or 60. And I brought out to Chicago at Reiner's invitation the 60-voice group. And we appeared twice, 2 years in a row, with the Chicago Symphony. Then he wanted to do the Verdi Requiem, and I didn't want to do that with 60 voices.
How many did you figure you needed?
120. And so they asked for a budget, and I said, look, this is exactly what it will cost, and I don't even get it, and my fee isn't even in it. And I think it was something like $18,000, which in 1955 was a lot of money. Not so small right now either, but that was a lot of money. And there was a gasp at the other end of the line, George Kuiper, the manager. And he said, well, we were thinking more about $14,000 or maybe $15,000. And I said, well, look, if you were thinking about that kind of money, why don't you start your own chorus? Well, he'd speak to Mr. Reiner about it. Well, I knew what would happen. And the next morning at 9 o'clock, it did. And the phone rings, I pick it up, and the voice on the other end says, Margaret? I said, yes. Reiner, as if I didn't know. And meantime, I'd gone to a hotel and looked up the Chicago telephone directory. I was not terribly well acquainted with Chicago physically. I hadn't been here very many times. And I looked things over, made sure there was a Harvard club, that there was this, that, and the other. And Reiner's first question, as I had thought it would be, is where do we get the singers? So I described to him how one gets a publicity out about this. You set the date and the repertory, then you go backwards from that to when you need to start your rehearsals, you go backwards from that when you need to start your auditions, you go backwards from that to announcing the auditions and announcing the fact that such a chorus will exist. And he said, fine, who conducts? And I said, well, I would be very happy to come out in Chicago, and I'm sure there's someone there. I would be very happy to audition for you. No, we don't have it unless you conduct. Well, that had not entered my head.
It hadn't?
No, it hadn't. I had no idea. So I said, I'll call you back tomorrow morning. So I got out my date book, and I looked through, and you know, you're always dated up for a year, year and a half, sometimes 2 years in advance. And I had nearly every Monday night free. So I called him at 9 o'clock the next morning, and I said, yes, I can do it. So I got on an airplane every Sunday night, came out to Chicago, did what administrative work needed doing Monday morning, did the rehearsal Monday night, caught a midnight flight back to New York. I did that for 5 years. I finally decided, oh, I think I'll stay in Chicago.
We're glad you made that decision. When you started, when you founded the chorus then in 1957, did you have in mind that it would survive, or did you think, well, these things are short-run engagements?
Chicago was not a choral city at that time, and there was no real conception of what a professional, a quality of professionalism is in the choral field.
The city was populated with dilettante singers, somebody wrote.
Oh, did they?
Yes.
Well, I wouldn't say dilettante so much as inexperienced.
Okay.
And my job was to lay down the disciplines and to see to it that they finally took it for granted that when rehearsals would begin at 7, they were there at 7. And to teach them to count, to listen. The whole basic thing had to be built into them. And initially, the board was this way, that way, about whether the chorus would go on. For the first 6 years, I didn't know whether the chorus was going to exist the next year or not. But I had to proceed as if it would, and always did proceed as if it would. And lo and behold, it has.
All right, besides getting to rehearsal on time, and I'm sure that's a more important thing than maybe just a sentence can convey, what else is involved in the discipline? Do you ask of these singers certain amounts of practice? Do you demand that they do what Lombardi demanded of his football players, that they be in shape?
Yes. Nearly everyone in the chorus studies voice. And well, when we have something like a terrible snowstorm, we lost 4 rehearsals for the concerts that we did the 25th, 26th, and 27th of January. I know that they studied at home. I didn't have to ask them to. I could take it for granted, and they did, because I wasn't sure that we would be able to get the handle, because those were the rehearsals that we lost. And they came having looked at both pieces, and I knew immediately, I don't have to change the program. They'll come through, and they did.
How many members are in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra Chorus?
Right now, we carry on the roster 233, but not all 233 sing every performance.
But that's a tremendous growth, isn't it, from 57?
Yes, it is. Well, the first year we had 120. And Chicago was a funny city in those days. It had the Second City complex. And I had some friends here, and they said, if somebody comes to sing for you and they can sing well, they won't be able to sight read. If they can sight read, they won't be able to sing well. I thought, what do you do to yourself? But if they can sight read and they can sing well, they'll never come to rehearsals. And I thought to myself, I'll fix that. So I set up the kind of audition that immediately set up respect for the chorus.
So there's a sight reading requirement in
that
audition?
Oh, yes, there certainly is. And they are re-auditioned every year.
Now, how many members are considered professional, that is, are paid out of that 233?
Well, actually, I consider everybody in that chorus professional.
The standard is the same.
The standard is the same. There are now 133 out of the 233. This is the first time that there have been more than half that have not, who have been, are being paid.
Would it be ideal to pay them all?
Yes, it certainly would.
So that's something that this community could shoot for in terms of financing of the orchestra and chorus.
What I also would love to see would be a smaller group, say 30 to 38 singers, who could do. There's a vast literature that Chicago just doesn't get. Mm-hmm. The Bach cantatas, things of this kind, even a smaller group, 24. And a lot of chamber music written for voices.
So that those people could have more of a living. You could say to 25 or 30, you can make a part of a living out of this.
Or a substantial part of the living.
Do you find that the fact that the people who aren't paid, do they perform any differently? Do they give you the same professionalism as the people who are paid?
Yes, they do. They do.
That's remarkable.
That's why I call them professional. Because profession doesn't mean being paid, it means commitment.
Are you comfortable when you see press reviews that call the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, the world's greatest. Does that mean anything to you?
Not really, I guess.
Because my next question is the chorus the world's greatest?
I'm not sure about that, and I really don't care about that. What I do care about is that it does its best. And you see, you can do one of two things. You can either get better or you can get worse. You can never stay the same. And the chorus has gotten so good now, it's very difficult for me to make it better. But I somehow have to find a way.
What are the other great choruses or choral groups in the world? I mean, is it the ones we hear over things like the Vienna Boys Choir or the Mormon Tabernacle or
the
whatever?
BBC has a marvelous chorus. There's another group, I think it's called the Ambrosia Singers, yes it is, that Imogene Holst conducts in London. I've heard some recordings of that, and the work is exquisite, absolutely beautiful. I'm told that in Russia there are some extraordinary choruses. And of course, in Russia, they have the really low second bass. They have the low second alto, which we don't have in this country, or almost don't have. Where they, when they sing a low B flat, it sounds as if they can go down another octave yet. And this sends overtones up through the rest of the chorus, gives it a shimmer and a warmth and depth that it's very difficult to get with an American chorus.
Do young great soloists who come into a chorus have a problem either with ego or with their own, say, potentially overwhelming talent? Or do you welcome a chorus that has all kinds of hotshot soloists in it who later on will be soloists?
Well, if they're going to be later on soloists, that will show also in the attitude, like Cheryl Milnes, for instance, who sang with me for maybe 5 years.
And who speaks very highly of you now when he's interviewed in the New York Times and places and refers back to that work as important in his life.
Yes. Well, when he sang in the bass section, he wanted it to be right. The most important thing to him was doing it as beautifully as he possibly could and learning how he could do it better the next time. Now, when that kind of soloist comes along, fine, because then the music is more important to them and the doing of the music than an ego. But if the ego gets in the way, it's no good.
Now, you are also the conductor of the Elgin Symphony Orchestra,
yes, I am.
Are you not?
Mm-hmm.
Is it much different conducting that orchestra than it is working with the Chicago Symphony Chorus? Are they two entirely different disciplines and routines?
No.
They're complementary to each other.
They're complementary to each other.
Would you like to go on and conduct? What if somebody came to you and said, okay, Schulte's gone on to other things, the Chicago Symphony Orchestra is yours?
I think I might think twice, but on third thought, I'd say yes, I think.
Is that what you wanted to do?
Yes, that's
when
what
you were
I set
growing
out,
up?
Yes, that's what I set out to do.
When did you start your musical interests?
Well, my grandmother had a pipe organ in her home, and the pipes were downstairs in the basement. And at one end of this very large living room, there was grill work as part of the floor. And I'm told that when I was 6 months old, I would crawl out in the middle of that grill work, and as she played the organ, I'd sit there and conduct. That may have been when it started.
Yeah, that's a fairly decent sign.
Yes.
And then you went on to play several musical instruments,
yes,
did you not?
I started the study of piano at the age of 5. And we had a very overworked a music supervisor in the public schools.
This is in Kokomo, Indiana.
In Kokomo, Indiana. So he often had to be away from a rehearsal for a little while. So we'd trade instruments. And I tootled away on the trumpet, on the French horn. I did take French horn lessons. I played double bass, and that only because he didn't have any double basses in the high school orchestra. He needs them. So I said, all right, I'll play it, knowing nothing about it. But I figured out from the tuning where what things were. And then when I went to Indiana University, I played well enough that I was the principal bass there.
Did you sing much growing up?
Some. When I was 16, I had about a year of voice lessons. And then I again studied voice when I was in college. And this not to become a singer, although I loved beautiful singing. Kirsten Flagstaff was my ideal of a beautiful sound.
Well, now, where I read someplace where you taught flying.
Mm-hmm.
During World War II. How did you have time for that? When did that start, the interest in flying?
Well, the war came along, and of course in that war everybody wanted to do, to make a contribution. And I was a sophomore in college, and the Indiana University immediately went on the speed up program. So I finished my junior year. And I couldn't see myself in the wax or something of this sort. I was a little bit too independent in spirit. And I thought maybe the women's auxiliary service pilots. So I could at that time pass the physical. So I went ahead and got a private license. And my father knew that I needed ground school and so on. I had to have a commercial license and multi-engine rating in order to get into the service pilots. And so he called a friend of his who was running a flight school for the Navy. It was civilians on the, and asked if I could go through the ground school. And so they called the Chicago office, and Chicago found nothing in the books that said no, that a woman couldn't. So I went ahead and went there, went through the school with the boys. It was one of these things that went so fast, if you dropped your pencil, you were 6 weeks behind. And got my commercial license. And next thing you know, you had to pass the Army 60 physical to get into the Women's Auxiliary Service Pilots. I did not have 20/20 vision. And it was correctable to 20/20, but you had to have it without glasses. So I got a flight instructor's rating and stayed on that field and taught.
Do you still fly?
Not any longer, no. But in order to fly, all I'd have to do is take a physical. If my eyes are still good enough, go and get checked out by a pilot, probably less than an hour, and I'd be flying around again.
I want to go back to your discipline. Is it true that when you get angry with a chorus, that the toughest line that you lay on them is, you sound like a church choir? Is that the ultimate insult? And what do you say to the church choral directors?
They usually laugh when I say it to them.
You've got several of them in the chorus,
yes, I do, yes. Yeah.
But what do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, everybody has in their ear a volunteer church choir where there are thin sopranos and who have a whipple wobble, and altos who try to make the voice very big and it wobbles around all over the place. And what I call necktie tenors, meaning that they sound as if their neckties are too tight. It's all pinched. And basses who also wobble around.
All right. Now, I don't think any interview would be complete, any interview with you would be complete without asking you to recall for us what at least those of us in the press have, I think, begun to call your greatest moment, and that's, I think, Carnegie Hall, Mahler's Eighth. Sir George Schulte is down, he's fallen and hurt, he's injured his back. What happened? What was that, 2 years ago?
You know, I don't remember. I think it was a year ago in November.
Okay.
A year ago this past November.
Is that your greatest moment?
Well, I don't know. There have been lots of moments. I had to learn it very quickly, and
how many voices are involved in that?
I think, well, let's see, we had 100 children and about 230 adults, I think, and of course the full orchestra and the offstage band that was on either side of me. It was a lot of people, but you know, that piece, the second part, is very difficult to hold together. That was the one that had me worried. The first movement of a classical sonata form, and it almost just does itself. But the second movement is very difficult because of the changes in tempi, the changes in mood, and being able to hold a long line from beginning to end with this. That is difficult to do. But I was so busy just thinking, you know, and I had studied, I don't know how many hours in the day and a half that I had to get prepared, and I was just thinking so hard that it didn't occur to me that this might be a great moment. I just had a job.
It's a great moment afterwards,
yes,
perhaps. Maybe we make it into something. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're a professional. You're going on out there and doing it.
That's right.
You're not romanticizing it as we do later on.
Heavens no.
If somebody listening to you would really have an idea now about some of the discipline, they might say to you, okay, if you're working your singers and if you have these standards and this discipline and this tradition and all of this that you bring to it, then how on earth can you handle all of those singers on something like the Do-It-Yourself Messiah? You must have to put on the brakes and do something else. Don't speak to me about that.
Well, you think very hard at that, too, because here's a group behind you and a group on the stage. It didn't occur to me that I couldn't do it, though, because several years ago I had gone out to Des Moines, Iowa, that has this huge KRN-TV theater there. And they had commissioned a work that included high school choruses. They massed all those in the city. children's choruses. They massed all those in the city, and they got together practically all the church choirs. Well, the church choirs were behind the orchestra here, the high school youngsters over here, and the children over here. The audience sat in the balcony. But I kept it together. And I thought, well, this should probably work the same way, and it did. The problem is you always have to keep your right hand with the orchestra, and you turn to the audience to give them a cue or to encourage.
And do you feel that audience gets with you? Do you feel the connection?
Oh, yes.
Do you make the connection?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, I feel like we've made a connection, and I thank you very much for being my guest, Margaret Hillis, the founder and director of the Chicago Symphony Orchestra Chorus. I'm John Calloway. Good night.